industry should pay for the damage that they create.
The answer is BP. We're not in that game.
We're a long way from yes or no yet on the question.
Because I don't have a yes or no answer. This is the most complex set of facts facing any area in this country. And you from England, I mean, what the hell do you know about it?
Okay, here's a question for you. Should the oil industry repair the damage they created? It's a yes or no. Yes? No?
I know no reason to make them do it. Now, if there's a reason to make them do it, somebody ought to make them do it. But I will tell you this, not my business.
It turns out that America's wetland has accepted sponsorship from several major oil companies, including BP.
How much has Shell Oil, BP, and the rest of these companies contributed to your operations? I'm not just talking about
you. I don't have a clue. I really don't.
You don't have a clue?
I really don't.
You don't know that it's almost all of your money?
No, it is not almost all of my money, but it has been significant. There's no doubt about it.
Of your money?
So what?
Wait, was that a yes or no?
I would say most, but I don't know.
You would say most. Yeah. Okay, yeah. I'll tell you what. Actually, you can't.
Stop.
Look.
We're through with this.
Would you all
do me a favor? Pick this up and get out of here.
Yes, sir.
Later, we discovered that King Milling was part of the Louisiana governor's delegation to Washington that lobbied successfully for an early lifting of the post-blowout ban on deep water drilling. Their blowout in the Gulf of Mexico doesn't seem to have gotten BP's way at all. Next on Dispatches, our journey takes us to the Arctic, the last wilderness on Earth, and site of BP's next target. The Arctic is BP's final frontier. In January this year, BP signed a massive deepwater deal with Russia's state oil giant Rosneft under the approving gaze of Britain's Secretary of State for Energy.
The British government welcomes this strategic global partnership between BP and Rosneft.
Their controversial £10 billion deal would open up access to over 60 billion barrels of oil in one of the planet's last virgin territories. Production could begin within 4 years. But BP is no stranger to the Arctic. I flew to Prudhoe Bay off the north coast of Alaska, where BP has been drilling the largest oil field in America since 1969. Way above the Arctic Circle, they've taken over an entire bay. Their current and planned operations here are crucial to the company's future.
We're in Dead Horse in Prudhoe Bay. This is BP's treasure trove. It's just above the Arctic Circle, and no one's allowed to film here unless BP says it's okay.
In March 2006, a hole in one of BP's pipes dumped over 200,000 gallons of crude oil into this Arctic wilderness. The prosecuting attorney said that BP cut corners with disastrous consequences. British Petroleum Exploration Alaska pled guilty to a criminal violation of the Clean Water Act and was fined $20 million. But it's not held them back in Alaska.
This is BP's new Liberty project. They're making a fake island, they're gonna drill down, and then they're gonna drill way out under the Arctic Ocean. We can only show you a map, because if we get caught filming 1 inch of the Liberty project without BP's permission, we could get busted for violating national security.
With 6 wells of up to 8 miles in length, it will be the most extreme drilling operation in the world. But their deep water drilling expertise is what makes BP such an attractive partner for the Russians. BP in Alaska has the state government right behind it. It recently slashed taxes on oil production. Almost half the state's income is from the oil industry. With such enthusiastic backing, there's little to stand in BP's way.
This is the last place on Earth. There's nothing between us and Norway except what's underneath, the oil that BP wants.
A local Inupiat leader took us to a remote sandbar in the Beaufort Sea.
Frozen gravel already.
I'd come to see one of Alaska's other treasures. Marine scientists warn a blowout at this time of year could mean an unstoppable oil flow for months. Crude could spread under the ice as far as Norway, devastating wildlife across the Arctic. BP told us it will develop the Liberty Project safely and carefully, and that it has a detailed oil spill response plan. Alaska's politicians, including Republican presidential hopeful Sarah Palin, opposed listing polar bears as endangered because that could halt new drilling. We left our half-ton friend to follow the oil, which flows out of Prudhoe Bay across Alaska inside this 800-mile pipe. It's called the Trans-Alaska Pipeline System, and it's owned by Alyeska, a company in which BP has the largest share. The pipe ends here at the port of Valdez. In 1989, the once pristine waters of this inlet were poisoned by 11 million gallons of oil spilled from the tanker, the Exxon Valdez. The oil was from Prudhoe Bay. Birds, sea mammals, and fish were wiped out, some species gone forever. The incomes of entire communities were destroyed. But although it said Exxon on the ship, responsibility for containing the spill lay with Alyeska, in which BP had the majority stake. For the last two decades, Dave Jonka has been monitoring spilled Valdez oil for the Prince William Sound Science Center and the Alaska Attorney General. Dave flew me over to where the Exxon Valdez struck Bly Reef, and then down to Knight Island and Death Marsh.
All ashore.
Alyeska's response to the Exxon Valdez spill was so slow that 1,300 miles of shoreline was oiled. They didn't have the equipment or personnel on site to deal with the 11 million gallons of crude floating across the Prince William Sound.
Big rocks coming up. Careful.
But within days of the spill, Alyeska said it thought its people had done an excellent job.
So here, I'm just kind of poking my fingers into this. That all looks black, especially with this rainy day, but using some clean water here to wash the dirt off. And then the stuff that doesn't wash off and is very sticky. As you let this set, you can start to see these areas start to leach out the sheen.
Alyeska's spill response plan said the company would direct cleanup operations of spills from tankers carrying Trans-Alaska pipeline oil through the Prince William Sound in such a way as to make federal or state intervention or takeovers unnecessary.
We could have done another half dozen all along. Look at some of our footprints here where I didn't even dig. Yeah. And there's a rainbow sheen just right there.
22 years and over $4 billion later, and the oil is still there. The Gulf of Mexico spill is estimated to be 20 times bigger.
These are great to take back in a Ziploc.
Wash some of the dirt off of this.
This is a special pad which just picks up oil, and it's not going to pick up water or other dirt once you wash it off. This is oil. 20-year-old.
Alyeska said it was only required to operate the spill response for the first 72 hours. A BP spokesman said the company has very little to say about the Exxon Valdez oil spill, and that Alyeska is an independent organization that works for an owners committee. Yet all but two of Alyeska's presidents have come on loan from BP. Along the coast, I met up with Dan Lawn, a man who was, for years, responsible for monitoring the Alaska pipeline and oil shipping for the state of Alaska. Lawn drove me along a snaking 400-mile section of the pipe. In the last 5 years alone, over 220,000 gallons of oil have been spilled from this pipeline. Sections of the pipe are undergoing maintenance near the salmon-rich Copper River.
So here behind us is the gate valve that blocks the oil flow towards the river.
In February, a U.S. government report said that multiple conditions exist on the pipeline that pose a risk to public safety, property, and the environment.
You have to do continued maintenance. That costs money to fix that. What we're trying to do is stop the oil from getting into this river. Copper River is where the most expensive salmon from Alaska and in the world come from. And you can't, the rivers flow so fast, you couldn't pick up any oil if you spilled it. So you can't afford to spill it.
Alyeska contests the government report and told dispatches that they carry out a thorough inspection of the pipeline every 3 years, which exceeds the regulatory requirements. In Prudhoe Bay, BP should have been monitoring its pipes with a piece of equipment called a PIG, a pipeline inspection gauge, a device that travels inside the pipes. A software engineer who wrote programs for the PIGs used in high-risk areas agreed to talk. Scared of upsetting the oil industry, he would only speak to me anonymously.
PIGs are pipeline inspection devices, and they're electronic devices with feelers on the sides like this that run through the pipeline and can detect corrosion damage or dents by these feelers being moved like that. So it gets sent through and it records all this data and accumulates it. You have to take the PIG data and compare it against what the regulations are for running that particular kind of pipeline. So for example, if there's corrosion damage in a natural gas line and there's a risk of explosion, it's less of a risk if it's out in an open field or if it's in a downtown area. So the PIG data has to be run against these regulations and these standards in order to correctly calculate the risk.
But is there classification for environmentally sensitive areas?
No. The regulations do not cover environmental, any sort of environmental impact. And these regulations are freely available on the internet and public for anyone to see. What they concern themselves with is human activity. So just to give a brief overview of the regulations, the lower classification covers open areas where there isn't much human activity.
But if it's in the Arctic and there's just some a few Eskimo out there and some caribou,
it's not considered a high risk, even if the pipeline has corrosion.
So we had those pipe breaks in Prudhoe Bay and on the gathering lines of BP, and they could have been caught by the PIGs, is that the idea?
Corrosion, dents, damage could have been identified if PIGs were run through the pipeline. But in running the PIGs through these areas of the pipeline, it directly impacts the revenue and the amount of product that they can deliver. Because in order to run a PIG through a given segment, the flow of oil needs to be shut down in order to run the PIG and perform the safety inspection, and then the oil can proceed. So it costs them money to run the PIG, it costs them money to purchase the PIG, and it also costs them money in terms of lost revenue.
Diagnostic checks can cost up to $1 million per mile of pipe. After the Prudhoe Bay spill, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency found that BP had not checked the integrity of its pipes for 8 years.